In this video, I'm going to be walking through my latest project in which I used DeepQ Learning to teach a bot how to navigate an environment with obstacles and reach a goal efficiently. So the project was implemented using the Gazebo 3D Physics Simulator, the ROS like Robotics Communication Library, and the Turbobot 3 repository. I'm hoping that this video can become a good resource for people who are interested in doing their own DQN project and want to see a style of implementing it and use it to apply this style to their own project, or just as an educational resource for those who are interested in AI. I think to get the most out of this video, you should understand a little bit about Q-learning, at least have like a basic idea of what vanilla Q-learning is, because deep Q-learning is sort of I guess you could call it an evolution of that. Basically, it's using a neural net to approximate the states using Q-learning. So in Q-learning, you're kind of you build this huge library of states and map them to action pairs, and you kind of figure out the rewards. Deep Q-learning is useful because in highly complex environments, instead of having this like huge state space like we would have in our gazebo, in our gazebo environment. Like every robot position would have its own kind of separate state space, every like angle, every distance to goal. So it would just have this like hugely expansive state space and would take a really long time to get accurate data or, develop a good vanilla Q learning. So what we do instead is we have a neural network and we pass a state to that, and we have kind of a similar algorithm to what's used in Q learning. It's a reinforcement learning algorithm. So basically the robot will start off trying different things and choosing actions at a highly randomly, and then it uses this feedback loop of rewards and eventually learns, good actions from bad actions and is able to sort of try and reach long-term goals rather than just using short-term goals. So that's the behavior that we eventually see with my turtle bot. When it starts avoiding obstacles, it sees that there's this short-term penalty. So even though it gets a worse short-term reward by, going perpendicularly to the vector towards, the goal, and it's getting a worse reward than going straight to it, it doesn't crash into a wall and gets a better reward in the long run. So that's the general idea in deep Q learning. Obviously, it depends between environments and whatever your goal is, but in this environment, the goal is to reach that goal tile very quickly, or as quickly as possible. Anyway, like I said, the format of this video is just going to be walking through the code. I think that the most logical way to do it is just go through the flow of the code, like as Python goes through it. I'm hoping to keep this video at least a little bit snappier than some of my previous videos, but given my previous takes, I think it's still going to go a little while. Anyway, without any further ado, let's just hop into it. So up here at the top, we have some libraries that we're importing. Nothing too special here. These are very common within ROS. They're basically just message formats, so whenever you're communicating between nodes within ROS, you need these libraries to be able to publish and receive messages. Here we have some variables to control kind of certain behaviors within the state. So for instance, we have scan min distance. This is the way that I'm detecting collisions with the turtle bot. Is you have this the turtle bot has a scanner on top of it, and once if which detects the ranges to the nearest wall. So once that if it falls below a certain range, then that's how we're detecting crashes rather than somehow detecting collisions within like the 3D simulator. Model speed, stuff like that. This stuff isn't too important or interesting. So let's just get into the loop here. So one thing that I want to do with this project is whenever you're doing model stuff, it's good to experiment with hyperparameters. That's what we have here. So this is our hyperparameter list. So we have stuff like the action space, the episodes, episode length. Basically, what I have here is I'm using an iter tools product function to help a user compare and contrast different hyperparameter combinations. So let's say, for instance, we wanted to see if we got better results with, goal 200 versus a goal reward of 100. You could do this, and it'll run twice. Once using the goal reward as 200, once using the goal reward as 100. Let's say that you want to change the epsilon to k, to 0.8 or whatever, and now it would run four times. So it would do a combination of 200, 992, and 100, 992, and do every combination available within these lists. So I did a little bit of that. That's how I wound up using the loss function that I did. It was more successful than I think the RMS loss when I compared those two. But obviously, like hyperparameters are a really big important part in machine learning. Just to get like, especially in professional applications where you really need that high performance. It's not about proof of concept. You want the highest efficiency and time and the best results. It's a big part of machine learning is to kind of perform those lengthy tests and figure out which combination of hyperparameters is the absolute best. So I figured that would be a good thing to implement in this project, though I haven't done too much of it myself just due to the time investment that it takes. Like a simulation cycle takes about at least like 2 hours for me, if you're doing a decent amount of episodes. But anyway, that is what that is all about. Let's skip down here. So this is just kind of generating hyperparameter permutations. That's what this experiment is here. When we're doing, we get every combination of values, and then so each experiment kind of gets mapped, and we build this dictionary of like one instance of permutation of those hyperparameters up there. So in here, we're building our environment wrapper class for the first time. So this is kind of the class that I have that's supposed to be handling kind of the interactions with the environment. The most important function here is that step function that I mentioned earlier that OpenAI uses to give the reward back. So you can see here, the most important parts of this function here are the getState function and then the getReward function for that state. So they do pretty much what they say. The get state function takes that turtlebot reading. So we take this ranges variable. Our ranges variable is read from ROS here. So this is kind of an ROS communication. We're reading the scan topic, and we get this laser scan, which gives us this array or this list of ranges that I mentioned earlier. So the distance to the nearest wall. It gives like 360 instances of that, so one for each degree. And we're passing that to our getState function. Our getState function, we're not taking 360 input ranges. We're taking, I think in this case, well, whatever self-scan ratio is. I think I put it as 12. So what is that, like 360 over 12? That's like 130, or is that right? I think so. That would give us 30 scan readings. Anyway, so we get our set of ranges, which are evenly distributed around around the turtlebot, and then we have this function here, which is get goal odom state info. So odom meaning odometry. So here we're just getting the x position and the y position of the model. We're comparing that to the goal. So one of our other inputs to our state vector is going to be the distance from the turtlebot to the goal. Another one is the angle. That's what's being calculated here, or this yaw reading here. So we calculate the angle towards the goal, and then we calculate the direction that the model is pointing in, and we find the difference. So we kind of get this, what I'm calling a heading variable, and that's a measure of whether the turtlebot is pointing towards the goal or not. That's another one of our state inputs, and then the last state input that I have here is this odom data twist angular z. That's the current angular momentum of the turtlebot. So if it's turning one way during one step, it'll act differently than if it's going in a straight line at one step in the same position. So hopefully that makes sense. So that's the state that we're going to be passing to our neural nets later, and that they're going to be associating with certain actions. So we take that state, this is our new state variable, and we pass that to our get reward function. So our get reward function is the function that I built to set the rewards for each step in the environment. So it's in charge of giving the crash penalty, it's in charge of giving the goal reward, and it's in charge of just if none of those two events occur, reward should be given, what reward or penalty should be given to the turtlebot. So the first one here, this is the crash detector. You can see if the minimum within the state that we got. The reason that we have the -3 here is that we have those three state variables at the end of this array, the distance to goal, the angle towards the goal, and what was the other one? The current angular velocity. We're ignoring those, and we're just looking at the ranges. So we're not looking at the last three in there. And so we find if the minimum is less than the scan minimum distance, then a crash has occurred. I actually have this other kind of workaround here. So this one's looking directly in front and seeing I have a different scan distance for the front of the bot than I do around the rest of the bot. So that's what that means. And we can see that if this evaluates to true, we print the crashed notification for the user, and we get this, and the crash penalty goes back to the bot, which it will use during the DQN function to associate the input state here with a penalty. In the case where it reaches a goal, so similar, we have a goal min distance. If it detects that it's close enough to a goal, we're going to say that we reach goal. We reset the state and we spawn the model, and we put back a goal reward. So now the goal reward gets associated with the previous state in action. And then if neither of those things happen, we're going to give a small reward. I have two modes here, but the mode that I settled on using most was you take the cosine of the heading towards the goal. So if you are heading directly towards the goal, you get cos of 0, which is, you know, the maximum value. And then if you're heading directly away from the goal, you get cos of 180, which is the most negative value that you can have. So it's kind of getting rewarded. It's getting a small reward for heading towards the goal, but you get this big bad reward if you crash into an obstacle. So the idea is, given those two combinations, the turtlebot will eventually find its way to maximize its rewards and head towards the goal, but around obstacles. That's our get reward function. Those are the two most important functions in the state in or sorry, the three most important functions in the environment wrapper. Like I said, I want to keep this video somewhat short. I'm going to be putting this on GitHub, so if you're interested in going through the entire thing, it's going to be there for your browsing pleasure. So the second thing we do is we create our model. We're passing the environment, and we're passing that instance of the hyperparameter combinations, and we're using that to build our model. So we have our init variable here. So the first thing the initialization function does is it sets the it associates the environment to the model, and then we create our models. So we either you can load an existing model, or you can create an one from you can create one originally. I don't want to get too much into like I think I'm going to skip the model generation function, but just know that it creates a neural net according to what you have within this gen model, and we also create a target model. So a target model is used in a technique called, I think it's double deep Q network learning. I'll explain what that is when we get to it, but basically it involves sort of a cloned model that is updated infrequently, and that in most scenarios leads to better learning in that the model isn't being changed constantly all the time. It's not that reactive. You kind of get these like milestone benchmarks version of the model, and use that to train your active model, your first model. Other than that, we set a couple of parameters, and we get right into our play episodes function. So this is going to return a set of scores. So for each episode, it returns a score, and I'm going to get a list of those, and also a name. Anyway, let's look at the play episodes function. So that is up here. The play episodes function. So we have our range of episodes being performed, and we have our episode length. So the episode length is the amount of steps within an episode, and an episode is there are two ways that an episode can end: either the turtlebot crashes, or that this kind of time expires, or so the episode length is reached, and then this for loop breaks. Within the for loop, the first thing that we have is our getAction function. So we have our initial state, which is given to us by resetState, or given to us by the step function. Our step function gives us a new state, which eventually becomes the state. So we take our state input, and we go to our getAction function, which is up here. So one thing that's important in deep Q learning and Q learning is exploration. So at the very start of the episodes, you have this epsilon variable, which starts very high, and that determines how often you'll be taking a random action. So we start with an epsilon variable of 1, or like 100, basically a 100% chance of taking a random action, and then we go through what's called epsilon decay. So for every episode, you will multiply your epsilon variable by a certain ratio, and the epsilon will decrease by that amount, or it will be the product of the current epsilon and your epsilon decay variable. And so that means that for every subsequent episode, your model moves less and less randomly, and hopefully your model is effectively learning and performing better and kind of finding an effective policy. Anyway, so we can see here in our getAction function, we generate a random number between 0 and 1, and we check if that is greater than our current epsilon value. And if it is, then we predict our action. We take the state, apply that to our model, and our model gives us a predictive action. If it's not, then we just choose an integer randomly within the state space. So that gets sent back here. We have our action, and then we pass that to our step function. The step functions we already saw. It's going to give us our new state. It's going to give us the reward for that action, and it's going to tell us whether or not that the new state is a terminal state. So what we have here is our memory. A memory is just a big list of, a combination of these five variables here. So we have our initial state that we started with at the start of this iteration, the action that we chose, the new state that we received as a result, and the reward and the done variable. So after we've appended that to our memory, we're going to be using the new state as our state for the next iteration. We update our cumulative score with the reward from this episode, and then And then, so if our memory has reached a certain length, then we're going to start performing our DQN learning. And this is when the bot actually starts to learn. So jumping into this function, we can see down here, we're going to be taking first a random sample from our memory, right? We're going to be initializing an input and output arrays that are going to be used to train our model. And then for every memory within the random sampling that we took, so first off, we get a Q array for the. This is from our current model, so not the target model, and we get the predictions as we would predict if this were to actually happen, within the gazebo environment. We check. This is checking whether the state is terminal. If the state is terminal, then we just take the reward as our QN, but if it's not terminal, then we're going to be taking the reward plus the max Q value of the new state. So that's one step in the future. We take our target model actually, and we're predicting the we get a predict we get a array of predictions for the actions, and we take our max value there. And we take that Q value, we pass that back to our QN. And then we replace, so this is the initial prediction that we got, which gives us predictions for values for each of the actions taken. And we're going to be replacing the action taken, the value for the action that we actually took, with this QN value. So the QN value is either the reward if the state was terminal, or the target model's prediction of the new state, the max value from the target model's prediction of the new state. We update our input and output arrays. And then after we've performed that procedure for each memory, we're going to be fitting these inputs to those new outputs that we got. Then in here I have this, so this is where the target network gets updated. So I have a memory count, and then once that hits a certain value, so in this case it's reset target memories, then our target model is kind of updated to the new model. So we have self target model set weights, self current model get weights. So now our target model, which is identical in structure always to the active model, but now it's gets kind of synchronized with it. So I'm having that happen, I think, every, well, actually I'm not sure, but like a couple hundred or a thousand steps or something like that. And then the memory count variable gets reset. And so that is this is the kind of core function of the whole thing, and like what how our model actually learns. It's kind of where all the data is being processed and where the actual fitting is taking place. So that's the whole like surrounding stuff is really just getting to that. That's where the learning actually takes place in this project. So the rest of it is just kind of handling the data that we get from that. At the end of this loop, we have our epsilon decay happening. So we if our epsilon is greater than our epsilon min value, then we do epsilon decay. At the end of the episode, so we I have a scores list. We're appending the score from there. And then at the end of all the episodes, we're just saving the model. We are passing back some values of the scores. So that's what's those graphs that I showed you in the previous montage, they're generated here. They get passed back all the way back down here. We can see after our play episodes function. And then here we're identifying which was the best performing model. So in the case where you do multiple permutations here, I'm finding the best average value for all of the episodes and the best over the final X episodes. So maybe if a model took a long time to learn but eventually learned a good policy, that's what this one would find. And then I'm also plotting all the results on the same graph. That's pretty much it. Hopefully this video didn't run too long. I'm sure I'll be shocked when I actually look at the time. But yeah, I hope that was useful. Thanks for watching.